Hey.
And we are live.
Hello, y'all. Welcome. Welcome. It's so beautiful to be here with y'all. My name is Ariel Julia Brown. I'm the founder and director of Black Spatial Relics. I want to welcome you to this program inside of our second annual convening. What are some foundational things you need to know? Let me find this paper. Black Spatial Relics is a space that amplifies the importance of Black radical performance traditions in relation to land, site, and place through the championing of works about and in conversation with slavery, justice, and freedom. Over the last 5 years, we've offered residencies, micro grants, programming, and convenings to gather Black artists and amplify their work that is undoubtedly moving us toward our collective freedom. And we will get to be deeply with that across the diaspora this evening. We want to thank our media partners on this convening. We want to thank US Department of Arts and Culture for their amplification of the convening, HowlRound, who is streaming this convening. And if you're unable to join on Zoom, I imagine you already know this, but we are streaming on Facebook. And that is a space that you can gather with us tonight. We also want to thank the Center for Experimental Ethnography at the University of Pennsylvania for their thought partnership with us and their amplification of the convening. We want to thank our funders at Added Velocity, administered by Temple Contemporary at the Tyler School of Art and Architecture at Temple University and funded by the William Penn Foundation for their support of this convening. If you are social like we are, we invite you to use the hashtag BSR5, F-I-V-E, or hashtag Black Spatial Relics in your posts about tonight. And this is one of our last events of this convening, though we will culminate tomorrow in our final gathering with Germaine Ingram for her closing keynote, and we hope to see you there tomorrow at noon. And I will hand y'all over to Jumatatu.
Good evening and good night and good day and goodness to you in whatever era of the day you're in. Hi, Mariah. My name is Jumatatu. My heart is beating quickly. I'm a Black person with kinky hair that is collected into twists and wrapped into a bun at the top of my head. It feels like assembly and soft organization, some sort of soft unity at the top of my head. I have a beard and a mustache that is growing in little patchy naps, a little unevenly on my face. I'm wearing an orange hoodie that, at least where from my vantage point, I don't know if this communicates from the screen, but it looks like noise, like the color of noise. And I'm feeling that. I'm sitting in a room surrounded by stuff that is not mine. The room is in a house on lands long cared for by Cherokee and Muscogee peoples. It's also currently known as Atlanta, Hotlanta. Among other things, I am a traveler, and sometimes I say a voyager. I love to and need to learn through change of environment, of community, of practice. And for me, when Ariel, and hey, Ariel, it was good to see you. When Ariel sent the invitation, I was so attracted to being able to convene a conversation, an imagining that was dealing with this notion of diaspora from the vantage point of voyage, of journey, of travel, of appreciating the width and the depth and the breadth of a people. And in observing, celebrating, interrogating that choice that it feels like I make, that choice of choosing Black people, which doesn't necessarily feel like a choice that I have to make. Is that true? Let's see if that's true. Maybe we'll discover something else in the conversation, or you can, you know, lit up the chat with your conversation around that. I'm so incredibly excited to be able to engage in conversation with three of my heroes, Muti Reed, Zinzi. Oh, Zinzi, I don't know how to say your last name. Love. Zinzi Minot and Henata Felintu. I have asked them to introduce themselves in response to a question that I thought could kick us off. And I think that I've been, because it feels relevant, and I'm intentionally trying to slow my cadence a little bit, understanding that this conversation about diaspora is inviting people who may not all be native speakers of English. So trying to keep that in mind, and also remembering that we have closed captioning for this event. So trying to keep that in mind as well in relationship to my cadence. I've been thinking about openings and closings, beginnings and endings, in relationship to trajectories, complicated trajectories, interrupted trajectories, circumnavigated, subverted trajectories, which feels to me like it has so much to do with this notion of diaspora. And I've been thinking about how I love to plan events, I love to plan productions. Inevitably, all the people that I want to be there show up late. And so there's, you know, this ceremonious beginning that all my people have missed. And I've been thinking about how to incorporate a notion of beginning and ending in all of the in-betweens. And so I'm trying to invite a little bit of a less ceremonious beginning, because I know that inevitably it'll be somewhere. You know, it might not start it off, but the beginning will exist, the ending will exist, and we are just going to keep moving through. I have invited Henata and Muti and Zinzi to respond to an initial question as an introduction to kick us off into conversation. And the question that I posed was, what does movement have to do with home for you? And I think this is a question that we can also pose to the people that are joining us via Facebook, via Zoom. Please feel free to lit up the chat. What does movement have to do with home for you? And can I ask that I've been arbitrarily resorting to alphabetical order, first name, when I've been emailing y'all. So can we just go in that order for the response to the question, which would be Muti, Henata, and Zinzi? Is that okay? That's okay? Okay.
If it's okay. Okay, I'll go first. No, that's fine.
Let's be
sure.
I would like
to go
first. I think just because of the language. So if it's okay, I will go later.
Sure. Hinata, is that okay with you?
Sorry. Yes. I'm start.
Yes, please.
Oh, so first, just a second, please. First, I would like to say good evening for all people here, and to say thank you to Jumatatu for the invite me to stay here tonight, and to Ariel too, and to my friends in this talk, Muti and Zinzi. I think it is okay to say how I am for the blind people. I am a Black woman with long braids, pink shirt, and the glasses. I am in a room with books behind me. It's my studio. So I am a teacher now, teacher, professor in a university here in Brazil. And what does movement have to do with home? I have one artwork that I asked to Joe to put after my speak. When I dance, I did the movements in many places here in São Paulo, at São Paulo, where I born and where I grew up. Nowadays, I live here in Ceará. It's another state, it's another place, it's so far from São Paulo. And I try to understand my movement as a Black woman here in Brazil, a movement with teaching, with writing, with creation, as artists, how a place, a secured place to, security place or secure place to exist. I think all these things that I do in my life as professional are two things that I do for exist as a person in diaspora here in Brazil, because we have different ways to be Black here in Brazil. And this understanding, I don't know how to say, Juma, can I help me? Tem a ver.
Has to
tem
be.
A ver.
Has to do.
Has to be.
Has to
has
do.
To do has to do with mixed race as a project to people here in Brazil. So when we talk of Brazilian people, the people in other countries thinking in a kind of harmony. Brazil is a place with many tensions because this kind of differences of skins, of color of skin. And it's very hard to people to understand that way of being Black in different places of the country. So I try with my artwork to understand that I am a Black woman in any place here in Brazil or any place in the world, because the other person when look at me see an African woman, and I think that my body is my home in anywhere. So I try to put this energy and this understanding in my artwork, in performance. I have our artwork called Danço na Terra em que Piso. Let me see how I can translate this title, Danço na Terra em que Piso. It's something like dancing on the land on which floor. And I try to connect me with some energies or forces that these forces are invisible. But these forces, these energies are here right now. And put me to movement to share with other Black people here how I feel as a Black woman. And I think that my feelings isn't the same that other Black people feel. I think this is, we have a subjetividade. How can I say?
Subjective.
Subjective. And this is very important to respect for us, because we are from the same place, but you have to respect these differences. So I don't know if we can show this artwork, this performance video before my colleagues, Zenzi and Muti, speak about this answer the question, or if I show after Zenzi and Muti speaking.
It's up to you. Now.
Why don't we, yeah, can we take a look at that? Is that all right, Muti, Zenzi? Okay.
Okay.
Sumaré me deu dois barajás na festa de Nanã. A velha deusa das águas quer me usar seu ibiri enfeitado com fitas e búzios, um ponto pra sentar, mandou cantar essa lugar. Senhora da Candelária, Abá, pra toda a sua nação e Yorubá.
girls do it well. Live faster, young bad girls do it well. Live faster, young bad girls do it well. Live faster, young bad girls do it well. My chain hits my chest when I'm banging on the dashboard. My chain hits my chest when I'm banging on the radio. Get back, get down. Pull me closer if you think you can hang. Hands up, hands high. Don't go screaming if I blow you with a bang. Get to where I'm going, gonna have you trembling. Live faster, young bad girls do it well. 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 My chain hits my chest when I'm banging on the dashboard. My chain hits my chest when I'm banging.
Ela causa, ela é bom, pior. Ela é mantena boa e Yoruba. Ela é vingativa, ela é de matar. Ela canta, ela chora, ela multa, ela compra, ela bebe, malandro paga. Ela é a festa na capa, os 10 na fita e eu também. Se vai, vai, vem, vem. Hey DJ, toca Mary Jane. Que ela dança, ela ri, que ela quer curtir. Quer beijar, quer amar, quer se divertir. Ela é zica na cena, ela é glamour. Ela é yeah. D-I-S-C-O, ela é 10 mais da Billboard. Ela é capão redondo, ela é xerém. Ela é black in love, ela é soul train. Ela é poucas palavras, talvez já viveu, já sofreu o sistema na pele. É Z-N-Z-S-O-Z-O, Baixada Santista, B-C-O-Z-L. Podia me aproximar. Ela opera a festa, ela é quem comanda. E a minha comanda quase preencheu. Mas se ela vier, valeu. Entendeu? Contos de uma festa black, a Cinderela, high tech, vai vendo o moleque. Ela foi capaz de entrar no banheiro e não voltar mais. Ela é...
Infelizmente a sua chamada não pode ser completada.
Onde vai? Mulher elétrica.
A vida, pois chorando eu vi a mocidade perdida. A sorrir eu pretendo levar a vida, pois chorando eu vi a mocidade perdida. Tempestade, o sol nascerá. Fim desta saudade, hei de ter outro alguém para amar. A sorrir eu pretendo levar a vida, pois chorando eu vi a mocidade perdida.
So thank you, Joey. In this artwork, I try to, thank you, Lindsay. I try to show how my movement appropriated the city of São Paulo in dialogue with many cultures. But they still connect with the past when placing bare feet on the ground. Movement and dance are forms of reconnection and a type of a homecoming, a spiritual home. This work was at the last Mercosul Biennale. And I think that to me was a way to think my condition as a Black woman and to remember that in the past, we don't have this kind of, label as Black, but as a person and the community and with a spiritual philosophy too, that this kind of condition of a spiritual being is, forgotten in this society. So I try to reconnect me with the land as I was looking for the land in a big city, a land with asfalto, Juma, asfalto, chão.
The ground, the asphalt.
Yes, yes, with the land above. So I think this artwork and this little words is an answer for your question. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so, Muti, Zinzi, who would like to go next?
So we've just been back channeling a little bit. I'm gonna go next. Thank you, Muti. Okay. thank you. It's really nice to see your work, Nata, and I wish I'd seen it earlier. Which is also really what I want to say about Black Spatial Relics. I wish I knew you earlier. I wish I had this peerage when I started making work, and I'm really grateful to be introduced to you and to begin that now with everyone I can see, my kind of co-speakers, but also the people in the chat. I hope the connections continue. And Juma, my friend, it's always so nice to see your name, and I'm grateful for the invitation. For those who are blind or otherwise visually impaired, I am a Black woman. I'm a dark-skinned Black woman. I have long Black hair with some kink on the side, which is inside a bun. I have red lipstick on and glasses, a red scarf, and I also am wearing a pink top as well. My approach, I guess, to answering this question is kind of note-taking or spitballing or like freestyling. I really wanted to be with the time zones. So I'm in London, and I was thinking about how to hide my tiredness, how to hide the lateness. Muti and I were just talking, and I said, actually, can I go next? Because I'm getting tired. And so if you see me yawn, it's also because it's almost tomorrow for me. And that was making me think about diaspora and the messiness and of trying to stay connected, and the different worlds we're always living in at the same time, and how we can manage that. So I wanted to be very honest with that. And I guess it's from that point that I'm talking from. I'm gonna share my screen at some point. It will be a mess. I'm gonna show you some words. I'm gonna show you some pictures. And it somehow will answer this question. So I guess the kind of most cohesive thing I have to say is about myself. I dance, I make films, I'm a dancer and filmmaker, and I look at the relationship between dance bodies and politics. And I look at how dance is understood and received, and my dancing body is understood and received through the prisms of race, queer culture, class, and gender. And I name class specifically in the UK because we have a very specific class structure as well. And I'm very much interested in where my body sits as a Black, dark-skinned, femme, lesbian, queer, working class, poor, non-thin body who has been through formal training of dance, which I think is also important to name as well. And I guess I work with dance and film, and it's something, it's important for me to complicate the boundary of dance and film. I really see my film works as an extension of my dance works. I'm interested in broken narratives, which is why this will look like this, disturbed lineages, the uses of glitch, and really just stutters and brokenness to consider my experience and experience of people that live like me and look like me and have histories that are connected to mine. And I'm specifically interested in telling Caribbean stories and highlighting the stories of those that have been enslaved and the resulting migration to where I am currently, which is the UK. And so that would place me firmly in the Windrush generation and lineage. So they're the stories I try to tell. So I'm gonna share my screen now. I may stop sharing it and then come back. Like I said, it's gonna be something. Let me just check which one I'm sharing. Yes, I'm gonna share that one. Okay. So we can get rid of my bio because I said that. So I guess as Hanata was talking, but also I've been thinking, I'm gonna move across the screen in terms of showing you stuff. So I was thinking about the word diaspora firstly, and I think it's important to name, I think it can in a way be forgotten that this doesn't specifically mean Black people. So when I think about movement and diaspora, I'm thinking about the movement and diaspora of Black people. And then I was thinking about definitions of words. I like to start with that sometimes, not because I have a particular respect or care for English, but because I think they're a launch pad, they can be interesting. And I was thinking about movement, and then I was thinking about ricochet, which is how it feels to be diaspora and be, for me to be bounced into a place that then rejects you back to another place. So I guess we can think about that in this like statement that is so often heard by diaspora, which is go back home or go back to where you come from. There's this ricochet to the place you were sent or the place you have gone, and the like non-acceptance of the land. And then I was thinking about the vibration of intended movement. So there can be one movement that you intend potentially to relocate, but that relocation can change you in non-intended ways. So I guess I'm thinking about when my mother explained my queerness to my father, and I feel like she was trying to be exceptionally loving. So I want you to hear that hear what I say with love. She was trying to explain to him that I was grown in the West, and that's something we have to understand, that our children are grown in the West. And she saw my queerness as a vibration of their original movement or their movement of people. Of course, that is incorrect, but she was trying to get him to understand something. And I think there are these vibrations, whether rightly or wrongly perceived, from the movement. And I think sometimes we can omit to hold those vibrations. So I was thinking about these words. The first work I made was called, well, not the definitely not the first work I've made, but a work I made that has some sort of beginning, as Juma mentioned, is What Kind of Slave Would I Be? And this work for me was trying to understand. It was trying to cast myself back to a time and understand. I wanted to believe that I would be a certain type of revolutionary, but I also wanted to hold space for the ancestors that weren't, that couldn't, those who did their work and died. Not everybody fought fires, not everybody killed people. And I kind of wanted to hold space for that in my memory and how I considered the movement of the people that I'm from. So the main image of the work is this one, which is actually this chair. And this chair becomes like a portal. So throughout the, if you look down here where my mouse is, throughout the course of the work, I visit this chair and I move through different time and spaces to think about the different people and a group that I think really moved me in creating this work that I hadn't considered before were a group of people that I started to refer to as the jumpers. So these weren't people that potentially I'm descended from. These were the people who jumped off the ship and never made it to land. And it was really important for me to dedicate a significant conversation to these people. Like, what does it mean to be moved so violently and to fear so powerfully that you will end the journey in the middle? And I wanted to give these people a real respect and space in terms of thinking like, who would I have been at that time? And to honor different ancestry that isn't just biological, but also to queer that and to think about everybody on that journey as ancestor. And yeah, this is a funny work because it's about objects, and I have a discomfort with objects and also the documentation of dance, which is why there isn't any. I'm very much committed to aliveness, and so I can neglect to document my work, but the object is the outcome of a dance and a sound work we made where we were making sugar, and the objects are kind of the outcome. I'm gonna stop sharing for a second because I want to come to my notebook, and I want to think about, when I think about movement and home, I naturally think very much about dance and the stored movement in my body, but I also want to think about the movement that names me and makes me other, that isn't dance. So when I was thinking about that today, I was thinking about how I tie my headscarf, how I behave around the police. Are these movements that name me as other, that aren't dance, that show my inability to feel safe and grounded in the place that I was sent and I'm ricocheting out of? And I want to think about those movements as well as the dance that I think so much more about in my practice. I like to think about the movements, you know, My lineage is my ancestors were enslaved. So much of what I have and what we had was in the body. And I verbalize that as different things, one of which is this ancestral interference, that when you're dancing and you feel something that isn't you, but you know it is you, and you just stick with it. And you, there's something about it that you're like, yeah, okay. And it can be frightening, but you trust it. And there's these movements that bond us and connect us, even though we're not codified, or all our movements aren't codified and organized and documented. And so I guess like the ways that I've thought about that before, and Juma, feel free to keep time for me, because I was supposed to set an alarm, but as I said, this was going to be messy, so I did not. So let us go back to,
and what I'll say, Zinzi, is I think we're approaching a transition. So, you know.
Okay, so I'll show you this last picture. I think this is a good place to end. So This image is from a work that I did called Gun Fingers and Opaque Bullets. And for me, I'm really obsessed with gun fingers, because wherever I go, wherever I see Black people collected diasporically, when we dance at some point, you will see this movement. And I'm really curious about how we've done this. I'm really curious about the kind of levels that we are communicating on a global and like close proximity, that we found these codifications of our movement, even though we're not, we don't all have one home. And yeah, I would say that they're my notes. They're my notes on movement and home. I guess it's not a cohesive output, but they're my thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. And Henata, and Jumatatu, and Ariejo, and everybody else who's here. My name is Muti. My pronouns are they and them, and Umuti. I'm from Philadelphia. I live in New Orleans. I'm currently in New Orleans. And I would say to this question of home, we were talking about this the other day. Home to me feels like migrations. It feels spatial. It feels like an embodied experience. I really like what Zinzi was saying about feeling something, and it's not you necessarily, but it's something that you feel that feels familiar to you. So definitely that. I've been migrating since I was a little one. My parents migrated first. They moved from their hometown of Philadelphia to Detroit, Michigan, where I was born. And then when I was four, I moved to Philadelphia, where they're from. And so the question of home makes me think a lot about who my people are. And not only, it actually makes me think beyond myself. It makes me think about all of the things that that have signified me, or that I signify. And when I say signify, I mean, you know, so when I go down south to visit my grandmother's people, and I never knew my grandmother, she passed away before I was born. But when I go down south to see her people, when my people down there who know me, or her sisters and brothers really, are introducing me to these other kinfolk, they always talk about, oh, Liddy Bell granddaughter. They call me granddaughter. Liddy Bell granddaughter, grandchild, you know? And so they don't know me, but they know my grandmother, you know? They know where I come from. So I think about that as a way to locate myself and to kind of enact and claim, you know, certain things that I feel drawn to, I guess. I'm gonna share my screen and share a little soundscape. I'm an audio and video artist. I like to make these sketches, and I'll share one of them. Okay. And I make these sketches, it feels like, just from noticing my patterns, and I collect like a whole bunch of audio from my daily life, from whenever I'm around, you know, relatives or friends or whatever. I have my audio recorder, I'm ready to record. Because I think this is a reminder for me about things that, there's a certain level of loss that I feel, I think, when it comes to this kind of structure of home, you know, that we're taught. Like I say, I'm from Philadelphia, you know, that's complicated for me, you know. It's complicated for a variety of reasons, but I think these sketches really help to locate me and satisfy some idea of who I am, home, kinfolk connections, a sense of belonging. And I like that it's way before me and way after me. So I'm gonna share this little one I did. I'll play it. Oh, wait a minute. I have to do something with the sound, right?
Yes, you can go to advanced. If you don't want to show your screen, and just click share audio only. So that way you can just do one less step.
So it's advanced in Zoom. Let me see. Stop sharing. Is okay.
Or Muti, you can do share and then just select the screen. And then at the bottom, it says optimize for video and it will automatically share sound.
Okay, I'm gonna share my screen. You said go to the bottom?
It's a small box with small letters at the bottom of the page that says of Zoom. You have to look at Zoom.
Okay.
And then you'll see.
This is way too complicated for me right now. I thought I was on point. It's not this select microphone, same as system. I'm gonna choose that one because I feel like I've used that before. Let me try this again. And please let me know if y'all can hear.
Lowndes County.
Can y'all hear this?
Yeah, it's good. It's good.
You heard it? Okay.
I live in Lowndes County in '42, and wouldn't come back as and forth to come back as and forth. I had hit my dad on the farm. I went to Montgomery Brook to town farm, come back here and hit him farm.
Let me see. Sorry.
Construction business that was almost like farming. the mic, blast it, and clean it up and drill some more, and then you build your road, then you got to where you had to build a bridge, set up for a bridge with your poured concrete buttons, dug footings out, and put footings down, and put walls up, retaining walls, and on the bay, across the bay, little bay, on footings and stuff like that.
So yeah, this work, you know, just to give a little context, this is, it's like how I find myself connected to the things that I've experienced. And I try to find every opportunity to particularly like with, I was started on this path when I was looking at Black sound. And I think since I've been asking this question about Black sound, it's like brought up a lot of like complicated things, because I'm not trying to like lock it in and say, this is what it is. I'm just trying to get a range and experience of what it could be, you know? What it has been, what it could be. And I think for me, when I talk to these folks, my elder kinfolk, and it's not even just elders. That one is a slow piece. That's my great uncle. He's telling his life story and everything. But there's other stories that I've collected that, you know, where somebody, well, a friend of mine, Diane in New Orleans, is talking about Cowayne soup, which is turtle soup. And that's a that's a New Orleans thing. You know, then I got another person in Kentucky. These are all people that I know talking about, you know, how his grandmother taught him to make corn whiskey. And so there's an element of like remembering and forgetting that I'm trying to tap into, because I feel a certain loss, you know, from, I think it was mainly, it's probably from growing up in Philadelphia in the 80s and 90s. This is my main preoccupation. Growing up in Philadelphia in the 80s and 90s with crack and with all of the shit that was going on in the culture of Philadelphia then at that time really impacted me. And so I think just from loss of people in my life who I really care for and loss of like things, whether it be like places or people or things, it just felt like such a loss. And so I'm always trying to remember, trying to recover something. And so when it comes to thinking about, you know, diaspora, thinking about home, thinking about these notions, I think about my folks, you know, the people and the things that I'm connected to, whether they be self-defined as Black or not. Like Philadelphia is my thing, you know, Philadelphia is mine, you know. Home is everywhere I am, right? And it's not in an imperialist way, it's in a way of being able to talk about it and tell stories, right? So yeah, that's all I'll share. Thanks for listening.
Thank y'all. And those are I've been a little bit following in the chat, folks. One thing that I'll say is that, because I know that I'll miss things, we will have a portion in probably about 10 minutes where I'll start to welcome in questions or commentary from the folks that are here with us. So if you would like to have something that you want to make sure that we don't miss, please leave it in the Q&A function that should be at the bottom of the screen if you're on a computer, and somewhere else if you're on a phone or a tablet, but it says Q&A. and you can and you can and you can write there. Thank y'all. Oh, God, the I'm thinking. I'm reflecting on this. Zinzi, you know I'm a dancer too, so I'm like this and I love words and the problem of having English on me, you know, is really curious. But I'm caught up in this vibration and ricochet, you know, it feels like they go together, vibrações e ricochetes. And thinking about how there's, Renata, you were talking about finding this reconnection with the ground, with the land, with the asphalt, through your continuous iteration of your stepping down, of your planting yourself there, of you being a part of that environment. Amidst all of those, the costume changes, amidst all of the different ways that you're adorning yourself, the different environments that you find yourself in, the ways that you're, what I perceived as the ways that you're changing yourself, the ways that you're using choice to change yourself. And also, after a while of, you know, it's I find this when I'm watching work from people that I know and people that I love, you know, it takes a moment to remember, you know, remember other ways of knowing them. You know, I'm like, I get so attached to like, oh, this is so-and-so. And, you know, like, I like the way they smell or whatever. And then so after a while, I started to try and invite myself to see all of the different kind of re-significations that this change of your clothing, of your environment was doing, and you responding, or you in conversation with that, those re-significations, those ways of, you know, the putting on new logic, which feels connected to this vibration and ricochet, Zinzi, that I think you were talking about, the search for logic and meaning, the search for a way to contextualize, you know, she's from the West. This continuous image that is found in so many places in the diaspora, and why, you know, like, what is that? Like, and does it always mean the same thing? What does it mean in this context? What does it mean here? You know, like, what are those, the ways that kind of repetition through vibration, those ricochets, that they create some other, you know, some possibility for astral jumping, for, you know, for finding some other plane to be able to, for finding some other plane as a means to, you know, to situate, to make some new sense, which that incessant sorry, the I'm trying to reference here that sound, which I love, and it's the moment that a new sound came in, it was like alarming to me, you know, because it felt like there was that stability of that kind of like orbing thing, and then it felt like the insistence of it as these other sounds come in felt like this other kind of resignification. You know, there's this text from, I think you said it was your uncle, that keeps being in conversation with this insistent, incessant vibration, and allowing me to resignify it, to create a new meaning. And I'm just thinking about how this thread, you know, I'm gonna ask a question. Please, folks, challenge me too, because, as you know, as a moderator, I'm feeling this responsibility to create connections, which I think are there, but also I don't want to reduce all of that just in the interest of having a conversation, because we are different, you know, and that difference is varied and all over the place and confusing and complex and gorgeous, and hectic. So back to the connection, because I really do feel it. It feels like this through line of re-signification, or what to do, how to situate yourself, ourselves, in relationship to the representations that we're carrying, what to do with that? What choices do we get to make about that? And I'm curious about, the question that I have is, what is at stake? What do you feel at stake when you're making a choice to confront, to capitulate to resist those representations that are on that inevitably, is it inevitable? Let's stick with that for right now. In that inevitably that we carry, you know, as a result of these identities that we map ourselves onto, that are mapped onto us, what is at stake in choosing, in making a choice to confront, to have a confrontation with that?
E deixa eu saber também, Renata, se está precisando de tradução.
Dessa pergunta precisa, porque eu entendi as escolhas que podemos fazer em relação a essa forma de representação, é isso que você...
Estou falando, just a moment, folks, just a moment to clarify. Estou falando sobre escolhas. O que... eu esqueci essa frase. Ah, o que está em jogo? O que está em jogo em fazer uma escolha para enfrentar essas representações colocado em você, ou que você se mapeia dessa representação? So.
It's good to translate because Maria, Fernanda, and the other people from Cariri, from here, is in with us.
Oh, so, welcome. Bem-vindas.
Okay. First, I think that the culture of Brazil is not as uniform as it can see with samba, capoeira, feijoada, and the football everywhere. And in my case, the experience of moving to another place is so far. This experience changed my life. So I had to find a way to continue to creating my art with respect for the people from Cariri, because we have another connection with land here. We have a name, sertanejo, is a people who lives in a place with less water, less facilities from the cities, the big cities. And I have to learn how create here without some technologies, without some facilities. I need to learn how to move around here with interest horizontally, I don't know, horizontally, respecting. I need to find a new way to reconnect me with the land of this land here, with the people of this land that is also Brazil. There is an internal diaspora here because the culture is so huge. And I brought a video talking about, because I'm connecting me with singers, artists, students that could show me how can I how can I know this culture to inside? I don't know how to say, por dentro. Ah, eu queria conhecer a cultura por dentro. To inside.
From the inside.
Yes, yes. So one thing that was important to me to continue my artwork and talking about movement, talking about ancestrality, is to know the singers of popular, I don't know how to say, folk culture, the old woman. So Maria is here now, and we organized a kind of meeting in a place that the senior people live here. It's a kind of asilo, I don't know how to say in English. Asilo. Island. Is that?
Island? Asilo.
Asilo is a place where the family put the senior people to live in. I don't know how to say.
Residential home.
Residential home, thank you.
Or like sheltered housing. Thank you, Zenzi. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you, Zenzi. But I think this kind of place is a place to forgot of these people. And we went there to know a singer and a composer. And I tried to connect me with this woman, invited this woman to sing her compositions, because I think she is right now in a kind of forgetting, esquecimento, I don't know how to say, esquecimento.
Forgetting,
yes, forgetting for part of the population, the people, the folks, for part of the history, because we have a new generation that sings the music he composed for this woman, but she isn't in presence, physical presence in the presentations, and she lives in this place now. To visit this woman is a way to put to other people the representation of ancestrality in connection with the present. Because I think that is very complicated. Celebrate these people when these people are living with us? And we have a habit to celebrate these people when these people aren't here. So I show this artwork to watch with you, but I don't know if you have time to see, because it is I think it have 5 minutes to.
Cannot, do you have a link to it?
Yes, I think. But no, I don't have it because it's closed. Yes.
Okay.
It's closed.
Let's see. I think that we won't have time.
A short.
Yeah. But see if you have a link of okay. A collection of images.
I'm finishing.
Oh, okay. Thank you. I was just Juma, do you want us to respond to this question, or was you gonna give another?
Oh, sure. Yeah, please.
Okay. I think this question of like what happens if I understand it correctly, and tell me otherwise, but like what happens when you confront, I'm gonna say like the images, for want of a better word, the perceptions of you. I think like invariably, kind of like without a doubt, for me at least, creatively, personally, spiritually, socially, that includes loss. Like it includes some shedding of what you knew, what you were known as, like the space between what you thought and what is, there's like a gap of loss that like maybe has to exist to bring those two things together. You know, the difference of like being diasporic and actually living for Jamaica for 6 months, there was loss. There was loss of what I realized I didn't know. There was loss of what I thought Jamaica was. There was loss of my, the fact that people didn't think I was Jamaican. You know, there's, and then there's a type of becoming that happened, which made me realize how much I was, you know, and it was incredibly painful, actually, to like, a little anecdote, I made a mistake in a patty shop in Jamaica, and this lady cussed me out, and she was right, I made a mistake, she was older than me, I was younger, she was on the right side of God, and it was my fault. But this woman cussed me out so hard, and she was a Chinese Jamaican woman, and she cussed me like my grandmother, and it rocked my soul, because I have never been cussed like that by anybody who didn't look like me. That had never happened to me. And it really, I left the shop and I cried in the street, and there was something that really rocked me about what I thought was mine. And it wasn't because she was wrong. It was because she was sharing in a way of disciplining me that I thought was mine. But actually it was Jamaican, and she is Jamaican. She just didn't look like me. And that was an experience that could only happen in Jamaica. That it wouldn't happen here, because people who cuss me like that here look like me. Like I very rarely meet white Jamaicans in England, Chinese Jamaicans in England, Asian Jamaicans in England, because the diaspora is small. And so there's a loss of like, what do you even think is yours? Like, what are you using to hold and pin up your identity? And it's fragile at times, and facing that can be painful. Yeah.
I think that it's it feels like that could be a useful segue. Muti, would you like to respond to that question?
Go ahead, make the segue.
Okay. Because I see a question from Dr. Omi Jones, which I'm so happy that you're here. And I'm wondering if I could read the question, or I think that I can enable it so that you could speak to us if you would like to. Let me see if... no, that's not it. Okay, if you would like to, I'm going to, okay, I've given you speaking privileges if you would like to, and otherwise I can read the question out loud. I'll just get it started, and if you would like to come on, please interrupt me. The question goes, thanks so much to each for this important expansion. If you could create a work among the four of you, what might that be? What would launch it? What might your collaboration look and feel like? I'd love to experience such a vibrant Black diasporic union. I'll tell you why of course you all have a choice. Like if you want to speak to this, I'll tell you what excites me about this question is that I know each of you in different ways and for different lengths of time, in different depths. And you all are really, just getting to know one another. And so we're swimming amongst all kinds of assumptions, which maybe we always are, but it feels like they're amplified. And that feels like a really complicated place
to confront a question like this, which is exciting to me. So I would love, and also like the idea to get to answer a question in a context like this is exciting. I'll leave it here. I'll speak to it really quickly is I think that there, I keep coming back to this notion of vibration, you know, and like the centrality of that of vibratory resonance in hypnosis and trance in elevation. And just thinking about that, like thinking about this image that Zinzi brought of like the confusion, you know, like the confusion around that vibration, around those ricochets. And confusion, you know, I feel like I'm vibing with this shoe. You know, I love the notion of confusion, of tricks, of the possibility of surprise, you know. And so I feel like I feel like vibration would have something to do with it, and I would personally be interested in that confusion.
I would say like one of the things that really excited me about the conversation is that we're all in different places. And I really like the idea that we're all Black. I like the idea that we're all Black, that we speak different languages, even if we think we speak in the same way. Like we say English. What's English? I imagine this space to be a space where we employ language, not only language, but, you know, dialect across regions. I imagine this space, I mean, I'm a dancer too. I do social dance. I'm not a professional or anything like that, but I love some social dance. And it's really hard for me though, because social dance is not, it doesn't feel like something that people do anymore. Everybody got the camera on them about some dance nowadays. You know what I'm saying? So anyway, but I imagine that it'll be a really exciting exchange of language, communication, whether through words, you know, dialect, through gestures, you know, probably some things that will be like, I talk about this all the time, matter of fact, you know, the tooth sucking, like how the fuck, like how that go from here over there to all the way over here, you know, and this Black women doing this, like how that go from all the way over there to all the way over here and all the way over there and all the way over there. It's like those kind of things amaze me. So those are things I think would be employed in our participation in an ensemble work. It's just amazing the things that we kept, you know, and the things that have been transmitted, you know, through not only our placement in a place, right? But the migrations, you know, there were migrations. There were Africans in Philadelphia at the founding of it. And I'm not talking about enslaved Africans. It's just how we arrive is pure magic. And so I would be really interested to play with that.
I'm going to jump in because I mean, you know, this thing about presumptions, Jumra, is so interesting because Muti, you say social dance and that's like one of my trigger words. Like I have a real issue with that phrase and like how it's been used against, I'm going to say Black and brown people, but I actually think it's something that happens more to Black people and Black dance. At least in the UK, there is like a codification and institutions that protect South Asian dance or there's something about being disallowed from institutions, but our dance is being called social when it was like, well, I couldn't get in your opera house, so my dance would only ever be social. That really gripes me because our dance only becomes formal when they see it and when it's codified and understood to them. So that's something that like I'm forever kind of trying to disrupt, that like because I think at least in a formal dance space, social dance is something that is said as a lesser than. It's a hierarchical system that I think is also a racial hierarchy, right? Like formal dance is white and classical, social dance is black and outside. So I just, well, that's why I wanted to jump in there. But I think, ironic coming after saying that, that this piece would be something that would be free of explanation. It will be something that we believed to be happening. I hate the idea of talking and explaining dance. I want to believe that we did it. So if we say we're doing a dance about ancestry, we do it, and then we don't go on a panel and talk about it because the dance was the conversation. And I believe we could send each other kind of international messages and believe that they were sent and believe that they were received, just how we see the tooth sucking and the gun fingers and the clapping, and we know that there's something that links us. I would hope it would be a piece that we could believe was happening even if we had no proof, which I think is so much like the experience of diaspora and blackness, is like to not have proof, but to know that something happened. And I would love that to be in the bones of like making a collaborative work. That would be special for me.
So I wrote my answer because I am afraid to be lost here. It's a long question and it isn't simple to answer. I have been trying to create my artwork that makes sense to more people beside me, that put me in contact with other Black people from all possible senses and the feelings. My last artwork are not individual artwork, have exchange and the knowing share each other. And the other person, how this person thinks this, thinks being Black here in Brazil is important to me because this meaning change. Perceiving the body, the movement, the medical herbs, the food, the voices, all as instruments and efforts to represent a broad notion of being a Black person and of Black culture here in Brazil, considering these differences. My last work is are collective. The last work had 25 people together, doing messages, fazendo massagem each other, and trying to feel the other body with herbs and the oils, essential oils, to, how can I say, ativar, to active, some sensibilities. And to me, this kind of artwork is with my idea, but to construct, to build this artwork, I need the other people. And I try to share, divide the financial researches too. Because the idea is mine, but the achievement belongs to all the people that participated of this artwork. So I try to give sense, give importance to these performances, sharing the experience and the money, os recursos, o dinheiro que entra, my fee, sharing my fee too. I think to me nowadays is a kind to to make sense beyond the of representation, but to think in the artwork as something collective, something that I can build with another ways to understand it, the body and the existence.
Thank you all. It's time to wrap up. So this has been beautiful. Zinzi, I can't believe you're still awake.
Girl. I'm so glad you said that. I gotta finish my dinner and I'm gonna be up for another hour because I gotta come down now, right? So
yeah.
You know, but I'm here and I'm grateful, you know. It was really nice.
Yeah, thank you all. The you know, these conversations are so lovely and so weird. It's a little fraction of a moment to make something happen, you know. Mm. And it's always like I always feel like, there's not enough time to make all, you know, all the stuff that I want to happen, you know. And part of that is also, I think it's the rhythm of getting to know new people is just slow. I think the rhythm of getting to know new people is necessarily slow, and I appreciate that. And I, you know, and it feels like it demands respect. So I'm thankful that for this space, for if nothing else, and of course it was much more, but if nothing else, to get to know one another a little bit more through this. I'm thinking about Zinzi, you were talking about those, these things offered without explanation. And I'm so, in thinking about spaces of translation, spaces of confusion, spaces of difference across connection, I would like to offer that each of us give an offering without explanation, and then we peace out. I would like to start. Beijos sensuais e rebolas eróticas.
Bom, é uma fala final, Isa?
Oferecimento, sem explicação.
Oh, I have to offer something in my words, with my words.
Or movement.
Oh. So, here in Brazil tonight on Friday for the people from Candomblé, the people from this religion that the gods and the goddesses are from Africa, mm-hmm. is a day for Oshala. Yeah. So I would like to share with you a sense of peace, creativity, and I think of connection with my ancestry. All Fridays, I have to cook for Oshala. I cooking a kind of, milho. Milho. How can I say milho? Milho is
corn.
Corn, yes, but it is a white corn. Is a food for Oshala. I would like to share with you in my imagination this food, and the shower is a shower with herbs, like alecrim. Let me see how I say in English, alecrim. Rosemary, a shower with rosemary. and lavender, lavender, lavender. So is a day for self-care. This self-care is a care with my spirituality, and I would like to share with you these sensations and these ways to reconnection that I do all Fridays. Is that?
Okay. I want to wish for us. That's what it is. It's a wish for us to understand and learn the ways that we are connected that we don't know. And whatever level that learning is on, and to feel the freedom and the comfort and the confidence and the safety to discover that with people that we pass and learn when we meet people who have our surname or knew our grandmother or cook that dish the way our people cook that dish, but we're not supposedly the same people. And I wish for us to find like joy and connection and reassurance in something that I don't know what that is, but the reassurance that something is happening and something can happen. I wish that for us.
Thank y'all. So I believe that Black people are masters of, well, damn, I don't like to use that word. We are, rhythm, like rhythm. We have this muscle memory about rhythm. And I don't mean just like rhythm, like keeping time. I don't mean like rhythm, like counting. I mean like rhythm, just as a natural thing, whatever it can be or whatever. So I'm just going to start off with my clap because this is what my my kinfolk, white, the English were particularly brutal. They denied Black folks the drum. We'd have had the drum in the U.S. It wasn't legal. You could get killed if you had the drum, right? So we had to come up with all different type of way to bring the rhythm. And so I'm just asking if everybody kind of like get with the clapping, you know what I mean? Make a sound. And like, I'm talking about everybody, because, and it don't have to be the same clap I'm doing, right? It's just a way of us being connected with each other, you know? It's like knowing that as you're praying, somebody across the continent is praying too, right? So it's like, just put in whatever energy, whatever diaspora energy is in that clap, sending it on, you know, knowing that everybody else is clapping too and we all in the same clapping, whatever, you know what I'm saying? We connected right now, you know what I mean? That's it, y'all. That's the clapping. Appreciate y'all for having me. I appreciate this Trans Diaspora Collective, this connections right here. I love being in conversation with other artists. I love being in conversation with Black artists. So I really appreciate Black Spatial Relics. I appreciate Ariel. I appreciate all the folks who are, running around, like, doing this thing. Jumatatu, I appreciate you. I love your field stories. Wait, is it field studies? Field studies. I love that, you know. I secretly, like, want to be a guest on there one day. But that's another story.
It's the same story. Let's talk.
I'm very grateful to you, Juma. I also just want to say before we go, Omi gave us a provocation. And I'm open.
Yeah.
I'm open. It's been fantastic to meet you guys and to hear about your work. and to hear about your bigger than your work. And I'm open.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that, Dr. Omi Jones. Y'all, this has been beautiful. Please be good to yourselves. Let's be good to one another. And until soon.
Thank you so much, people.
Good night. Good morning.
Thank you.
Yeah. It was a pleasure.
Take care. Ciao, ciao, ciao.
Actually, before you turn it off, I want to get the chat, Jyoti, or whoever's controlling.
Are we staying whilst we go off live?